Now this, for some, might be a normal racetrack in Cape Town called Killarney International Speedway. For me growing up, this was an amazing place to spend some time. I'll tell you why. Because local motor racing was alive and well, pretty much as it is now after COVID. And I say after COVID, because we're still reeling after a pandemic, but we're able to go and support local motor racing now. And when I think of local motor racing, I think of a couple of names synonymous with South African motor racing. And this gentleman that is our guest this week is one of those legends, a man who's truly not only graced this track, but many tracks around the world. Not only graced them, but dominated them. Now he finds his time looking after a fleet of cars, not only for some top manufacturers, but also every now and then coming out of retirement to take journalists, to take people, and to kind of compete every now and then. The world-renowned and local legend, Deon Joubert.
Hey, Ryan.
How's it,
bud? Thanks for that intro.
Lekker. And the privilege of knowing you, I've tried to do the math, but it's over 20 years that, we've been mates.
Maybe more. Yeah.
Maybe even more. And in that time, I mean, you literally just, you were still had one foot in racing and one foot kind of out of racing when we first met. And you showed me kind of the ropes in terms of the local motor racing scene. Your love for motor racing is, I mean, it's so deep and entrenched, and it's in the family. I want to chat more about that, chat more about your career, and importantly about your work with some of the most amazing brands in the world. I know you don't often get to drive them because you look after the press fleets, but sometimes we find when we're picking up a car from you or dropping one off, Deon Joubert is there himself to make sure that we get the keys to the vehicle and find out more about the car. And that's exactly what we're going to do today. So Deon, hop in this car and let's go around the track. Right, in the car with Deon Joubert. Deon, what car is this? This is the
i30N.
This is the
Hyundai i30N.
But the
I think it's called a DSG.
A DSG box. Yeah. I've driven the manual one.
Yeah.
Talk to us a little bit about what we're getting here.
Okay, so the previous i30N was a manual.
Yeah.
This car's got this dual clutch gearbox.
Yeah.
And it's really very good.
And your preference between the manual box?
I think at the end of the day, I'd probably just have this.
Yeah. Because it makes it easier. I mean, the world of DSG has really made an average driver a great driver.
Correct.
Because there's no heel and toe, there's no kind of a specifics on learning your gearbox and where to be.
And also, if you, you know, for me, when I come and do the track laps, there's no guessing which gear you need to do a corner in because you just get another gear.
Yeah.
So it's kind of nice. Yeah.
You've driven the Kona N, and in actual fact, you've driven almost every N variant that Hyundai put out to market.
Yeah.
What the kind of difference between this and, this, for example, the Kona?
Well, the Kona is a
bigger vehicle,
very similar car, but it's slightly raised. It's got slightly different
characteristics
because of that, and maybe a slightly softer ride, and it'll be slower around the track.
But gotcha.
It might be a better car for day-to-day use.
Yes.
Although my preference is strongly towards the i30N.
I love this i30N.
Because I think if you're going to buy a car like this, you may as well buy the fastest one.
Absolutely. Talking of fast, you are known to be a hell of a fast driver on and off the track because it's in the blood.
Oh, thank you.
Let's talk about growing up and being in motor racing. Obviously, there's a motor racing heritage in the home because your dad was really so close with motor racing.
My father was involved with this racetrack from the 50s, pretty much built everything here. So I spent a lot of time here as a kid because he spent a lot of time here.
Yeah.
So then I just came with and I was thinking about it the other day because I don't really do ball sports and team sports very well.
Right.
So I'm a sort of an individual sport guy, and I really just fit it into motorsport. I understand the competition between drivers, the whole the system of it, and whatever. So what I always say to people is, if you let's imagine you're a world level sportsman starting out somewhere.
Yes.
Let's just say surfing at Mount Force or running at school or whatever. At school you beat everybody. Then when you go to the inter schools, it's a little bit more difficult.
Sure.
When you go to the inter provincial, it's a bit more difficult.
Yes.
But maybe you're still the best in the country.
Got
by the time you get to the Olympic Games, it's actually not about how fast you can run anymore. It's about your mental game.
Sure.
So motor racing is like that. So most of the guys that got into touring cars, let's say get into Formula One or any top level, they dominate on the way there.
Yes.
So now you have a situation in Formula One where, let's say, George Russell dominated. He's a part of the junior formula.
Yeah.
But now he's got Hamilton. Yeah. And guess who dominated? When he was in a junior career, it was Hamilton. So these guys end up racing each other, and now it's very, very hard.
Sure.
And in motor racing, there's something different to normal athletes is you have to also get equipment.
Yes.
So it's pointless being the best driver in the world if you're not in a Formula One car. Mm. And even if you're not in the right Formula One car.
Sure.
And then if you're in the right Formula One car and your teammate got the better engine.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's a lot of equipment related things in motor racing.
So how was it for you then? Because I mean, did you find it expensive? Was it an expensive sport?
It wasn't as expensive
to grow up
then,
and participate.
And there was also. My father started Group N Racing.
Wow.
And Group N Racing created a relatively inexpensive path into touring cars.
Sure.
Which actually didn't exist at that time.
But gotcha.
So in retrospect, it looks like it was clear.
Yeah.
But it wasn't really. There was a whole lot of luck involved in me getting into the BMW touring car in the end. But that path is gone from South African motorsport.
Yeah.
There is no way anymore.
No.
There's no manufacturer participation.
Yeah.
Put it that way. And there was massive participation from the manufacturer.
So yeah. Talk about your first string of successes that kind of moved you. I love this car. That kind of moved you up the ranks
in terms of going from karting all the way through to championship.
Yes.
But my real breakthrough came when I won the South African Formula 4 Championship.
Yeah.
And then there was a chap called Owen Ashley who just moved down to Cape Town. Anyway, so I won a whole lot of races, and that got me noticed by BMW. A young guy called Hilton Cowie moved out of the way because he went to Europe to race, and I got his. Maybe he would have got the drive, I'm not sure. And then I was in a BMW car, and the next thing I was racing three cars at once.
When you, like, if I say now, I mean, we can talk about now where you are currently in life, and that's looking after some of the most amazing. We're in one of them. This is the Hyundai, but you look after, in terms of press fleets.
So I look after eight press fleets.
Okay.
And just explain to people, it's basically the manufacturers have motor cars. They own the motor cars.
Yes.
They're owned by dealers.
Yeah.
And they use them to promote their their newest vehicles. So we always have the newest vehicles, often before they even are for sale.
Absolutely.
And it's just astounding. I mean, I grew up around old cars, and I understand that old cars are crap compared to new cars.
New cars,
The new cars are just flippin' amazing.
I know.
If you had brought this Hyundai or any of the new Mercs or Toyotas or whatever to the track in 1980, it would have been absolutely tricky, you know?
Yeah.
So these cars go, they stop. That they're not particularly heavy on fuel for the speed they do, and they don't brake. The idea that you can buy a 600 horsepower motor car with a warranty it's just, you know.
I mean, that's the thing, is people often say, I want to buy a car, give us some advice. You can't, because it boils down to taste. No one's manufacturing bad cars. Now, gone are the days where you unfortunately had to say, well, I can only afford to get myself into X or Y because that's all my money would allow me.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry it breaks down all the time, but I am.
Cars are more expensive, but they also offer more, you know?
Yeah.
So the first Golf GTI that I raced had 82 kilowatts. Its end cap was probably minus something.
Got
and,
you.
But I remember that it cost 5,000 rand.
Jeez.
And it was in 19 whatever. But you know, if you think what's in one of these cars now, in terms of the radio, the safety, it's just so much more.
Okay, so talk to us through about some of these lines. You must know every single bump, every single little detail of this track.
I know the track very well. I have a certain.
Here's the bump you're talking about now.
So there's a line in the tire.
There. Boom.
So if you could brake on just past that bump, but generally you don't.
I saw you racing a couple of weeks ago. Yeah, I was in the stands. You're shouting my lungs out at my kids. My kids were shouting, go on, Uncle Deon.
And I think because the car didn't quite suit my driving style, and I'm too lazy to change it. So my driving style is very rear-wheel drive oriented.
Okay. And you're driving a front-wheel car.
It was a four-wheel drive.
Yes.
Yeah. So in this corner particular, Ashley was much quicker than me because he was able to rotate the car.
I got you.
I was causing a bit of understeer.
What is this, a front-wheel or rear-wheel?
This is a front-wheel drive car.
Okay.
Yeah.
And we're going nicely along here on these racing lines, and these are pretty...
So the idea is to maximize your throttle time,
and
be on the throttle as much as possible, so you go into corner in an exaggerated late way.
Right.
You turn into what we call the apex, and you accelerate through the apex. Okay. So the idea is to make the exit as straight as possible and to be on the throttle as long as possible.
Okay.
And at the same time, brake as late as possible.
Okay.
But some corners you don't brake as late as possible because you then hurt your entry speed. So the corner like this,
you got to try and balance yourself,
create momentum. Yeah. So in general, in a slow corner, you can brake late and sort of mess up the corner, but because the speed's lower and the car can pick up the speed easier.
Yes.
In a fast corner, especially in a relatively underpowered car, the word is traction limited.
Okay.
Or traction, it's got too much traction.
Got you.
You want to create momentum, like you on a bicycle.
Bicycle, sure.
So if you in a slow corner, the car can pick up 2 or 3 k's an hour easier. But if you're doing 150 k's now, it can't pick it up so easy. So we really worry about the momentum in the fast corner.
Jeez, that's brilliant. It's very insightful, especially around a track like this. And for anyone who wants to get into racing or take their car on an open track day to Killarney International Raceway, it's kind of quite interesting to hear how racers take their lines and how they.
Yeah, I know.
So listen, what else is on the cards for you? I know you, like we've mentioned, you run this.
We're still doing some odd stunts and commercials, which is very nice. And I'm going to go do the Simola Hill Climb with the BMW.
I'll be there as well.
Which I'm very excited about.
I'll be there.
It's a rear-wheel drive car, so it's going to be a little bit of a problem at the start. But other than that, it's going to be absolutely fantastic. Love driving that car. And the wonderful thing for me is actually associating with all these different manufacturers and experiencing them.
Yeah. I'll never forget 1 year you and a Jag up there.
Yes, I've driven the Jag. Oh. Did lots of time in the Renault Megane, which is my favorite car. So it's been really great driving all of the different cars. Yes. I think I've driven more than 250 cars around this track for the laps for Car Magazine. I don't know if anybody in the world's done that.
I don't think so. Yeah, well, certainly you've got the record in Cape Town because Car Magazine have not used anybody
record
else.
In Cape Town!
You know, that's 250 cars around.
And mostly without mishaps. So we did crash that one Lamborghini, which we didn't speak about much, but and
to never be mentioned again.
Never to be mentioned again. Otherwise, it's been cool.
It's been incident free.
Yeah.
But I love that. You've always been about safety first. And Deon, listen, thanks a million. It was lekker spending time with you. And importantly, being your mate is even better. So thanks a million for all of this. And remember to like, subscribe, click on the links. And for the latest and greatest in Car Magazine content, we've got you covered.